My name is Emmanuel, Byamukama, and I'm the extension plant pathologist. And I will present on corn diseases, and later Connie Strunk will present on soybean diseases. But one other person that I would like to introduce to you is Kay Rudin, and she's the research associate, and she really does a great job when it comes to fungicide trials, both on soybean, corn, and wheat. So for diseases on corn, I would like to ask you, what are some of the diseases that you're seeing out there? Any issues with common rust? How about Goss's wilt? Some? Okay, well, so the corn diseases part is the last four pages of the handout. So if you can go there. And what I would like to start with, sort of to highlight general information, this applies to any crop, any pathogen, is what plant pathologists call disease triangle. Okay, and what that means is you have to have three factors for disease to develop. And this sounds like common knowledge, but you would be surprised how many of us consult or try to think about disease triangle before we go out and apply a fungicide. Okay, so for a disease to develop, you need three factors. The host, which has to be susceptible. You have to have a virulent pathogen, so not any pathogen can cause the disease. You may have a race that's not virulent on a particular cultivar. So a susceptible host, virulent pathogen, and a favorable environment. And the reason I wanted to highlight the three factors is because of the environment that we're having. This is really unusual for August weather. You know, it's relatively cooler. And so because of that, we may not see some common diseases that develop on corn and soybean. Okay. And talking of cooler conditions, we may not see great leaf spot develop because great leaf spot will not develop when temperatures are below 75 degrees. So it's a warm living pathogen. Okay. So again, highlighting the importance of disease triangle when it comes to managing diseases. Ida mentioned applying fungicides, you know, kind of in a way that is not following whether there's enough disease to warrant a fungicide application. I've had calls, you know, people asking, I have common rust on the lower leaves, should I apply a fungicide? And I ask, how much is out there? Okay, that would be a question that we'll discuss later. But disease triangle is important. When it comes to a hybrid, you want to ask yourself, what hybrid I plant? Is it something that is susceptible to Goss's wilt? If I have Goss's wilt now, next time in my field, I want to make sure that I have that cultivar that is resistant to Goss's wilt. If it is common rust, whatever it is, you want to keep track of what you see on your field and then the selection of the cultivar or hybrid that we'll plant for next season. So disease triangle is really important. Both the environment, the host, and the pathogen must interact together. And the extent of the overlapping of these three factors will determine how much disease pressure we have for a respective season. Okay. All right, now let's look at some of the diseases we've seen developing on corn. And the first one is Goss's wilt. I do have here very nice looking leaves that have really good symptoms of Goss's wilt. The way to diagnose Goss's wilt is look for those black freckles on the leaves. That would be a diagnostic feature for Goss's wilt. Sometimes you may also see water soaking, especially at the end of the lesion where it's expanding on the leaf. And then you can also see a shiny ooze of the bacteria. Okay. Now, the bacteria that causes the wilting and the leaf blight survives on corn residue and to enter the plants through wounds. And that's why we've seen most of the reports of Goss's wilt coming from the northern counties where they've had a number of hail events. So hail, high winds, insect damage, those will be avenues for the bacteria to enter the plants. Now, if you have a plant infected so early in the season, then you may have the wilting stage, like the whole plant gets wilted. If you get infection later in the season, then you may have the leaf blight phase of this disease. So how do we manage Goss's wilt? Should we apply a fungicide? Why not? Because fungicides only control fungal pathogens, okay? And we've seen in other crops, if you apply a fungicide, you may make some other diseases even worse, okay? So it's important you diagnose what you have so that you can have a proper treatment or a proper management decision for that particular problem. So Goss's wilt can be managed through different ways, and they are what I've called three arrows. So rotation, in other words, plant a non-host for the pathogen. So for Goss's wilt plant, rotating in two bins is going to reduce inoculum because the bacteria survives on infected residue. Okay. The second R is plant a resistant hybrid. We have, luckily the companies provide ratings for Goss's wilt, and so if you're planting corn on corn, or you know, you're having no-till corn, then the inoculum is going to be high. So you may want to look at using a resistant hybrid of corn. The third R is the residue management, because the pathogen survives in the residue. So if you're in a part of the country where tillage is okay, then tillage would reduce the inoculum. But in other areas, you know, where tillage is not recommended, then you can use other methods to control Goss's wilt. Right, now the second bacterial disease that we have seen on a very low incidence is Holker's spot. Holker's spot is caused by another bacteria called Pseudomonas syringae, pathova syringae. This is a bacterial disease that has a wide host range. It can also occur on soybeans. But luckily on corn, this disease never develops levels to cause concern. In other words, we don't have high disease pressure that causes yield loss. Okay. The bacteria also, like Goss's wilt, survives on corn residue. So its management is going to be effective if you rotate away, as well as managing the source of inoculum, which is the residue. So tillage, again, can reduce the source of inoculum for this disease, Holker's spot. The way to diagnose it is, if you look on the second page of the corn diseases, is look at the round, kind of elliptical shaped lesions that are, their color is between white and tan, like a tan to white color in the center of this lesion. Okay, they are really small, so you can't confuse them with Goss's wilt. And again, this disease is not a big concern. Most of the hybrids have good resistance to Holker's spot, but occasionally you may come across this disease. The other disease that we see is common rust. And just like the name suggests, common rust is pretty common. Every field that I've gone to, I have found this disease. Every corn field pretty much is going to have common rust. Now, unlike the rest of the diseases on corn, rust pathogen does not survive in South Dakota. Spores have to be blown from southern states northwards. So crop residue or rotation is not going to do anything about rust development. And this is where I'm having questions. So how much rust do I need to see before I can apply fungicide for managing common rust? So any of us has already applied a fungicide on corn? That's really good. Because in here we have different fungicide timings that we have for demonstration purposes, as well as experimentals that we're evaluating. But as you can see, this is an untreated corn, and there's pretty much nothing. So just like Adam mentioned, we need to be careful when it comes to applying these management tools that we have, because we may misuse or overuse some of these, and in future where we're going, we may land ourselves into trouble. So we're really encouraging scouting and making sure that you have enough disease that's developing to warrant a fungicide application. That way, you're not being too hard on natural enemies, as well as setting a stage for resistance development. Okay, so common rust, we recommend about 15% of the entire plant covered with the pustules to be the threshold for fungicide application. Less than that, the rust is not going to be a significant factor to cause yield loss. Okay, most of the rust now that is developing on corn is on the lower leaves, and we know that the leaves that impact yield would be from the ear leaf upwards. Okay, so if you see some rust on lower leaves, it's not a big deal. I would wait before I can apply a fungicide. The other disease that we're seeing is common smut. I have an ear here of corn that has nice looking galls of common smut. Now, common smut this season was a concern because it was appearing on leaves as well. So growers were wondering, what is this that's coming through leaves? But common smut can infect any part of the plant as long as it finds the entry point to the part of the plant. So for leaves, this season where we had hail, some of those developed common smut. Now this fungus, those galls you see are full of spores, okay, and then they will dry out and spread by wind all over the place, and they can survive in soil for a long time, okay. But likely, for common smut, it's not a disease that will cause yield loss, and it's also, it will infect a few plants here and there, and never develops to a levels that will cause yield loss, okay. So we shouldn't apply a fungicide to control smut because it rarely develops to become a disease of concern. Okay. The other disease that you may see here and there is a physoderma brown spot. This is a fungal disease that also survives on corn residue, and it usually loves a lot of moisture. So where you see it develop would be on the leaf holes, so where the leaf joins the stem, because sometimes you have moisture sitting there, and when the spores land there, they infect that part of the plant. And later when the leaf expands, then you will see kind of these lesions at the center or the midrib of the leaf. And the picture that I have in the handout should show you the symptoms of this disease. So it's also a residue borne, and so controlling it would mean rotation and residue management, as well as using resistant cultivars. This disease likely also never develops to levels that will cause yield loss. So it's usually not a concern, but it's something that we have noted in cornfields so far this season. Some other diseases that may develop but we have not seen include gray leaf spot, eye spot, northern leaf blight. This morning I saw one lesion on just one plant here in this field. All these three diseases survive also on corn residue, but they love warm conditions as well as high humidity. We have had enough humidity to see some of these diseases, but because the temperatures are more to the cooler side, we may have a delayed development of some of these diseases. But anytime you have a residue-borne disease, you know you have the inoculum in the soil. So the best thing to do is to scout and make sure that there's a significant level of the disease that warrants fungicide application. Okay, so scouting and then rotation. You know, this would be for the next growing season, of course. We already have a crop here. And then resistance. Then if you have to apply a fungicide, then you should be guided by how much disease you have there. Again, consulting the three factors. What hybrid do you have? Whether the weather conditions are, do we have conditions that may promote disease development? Or should we, you know, watch the situation, keep scouting until we have enough disease pressure to warrant fungicide application? Okay. So with the scouting, you could save yourself fungicide application and increase the profitability if the disease pressure is not that high to warrant fungicide application. So any questions on diseases on corn? Okay, no issues? Okay, great. So I'll hand over to Kani and then she'll talk about soybean diseases.